In 2003, war broke out in Sudan. The Darfur genocide claimed the lives of hundreds of thousands. Fleeing death and persecution, many headed for the modern state of Israel, believing they would find refuge in the only proclaimed democratic state in the so-called Middle East. The welcome they anticipated was shattered on their arrival. This documentary tells the story of Sudanese asylum seekers in Israel, their experiences, complications, their sorrows and struggles. Thank you, brothers, for having me here, Holot, and I want to say thank you for, you know, willing to have an interview with me about your circumstances situation, which I think is crucial that people know what you've been through and what you're going through at this current time in Israel.
We really do appreciate it, you coming from a long journey to hear our history here in Holot. And my beginning, Holot, I would like to thank the government of the state welcoming us as African refugees here in Israel. And of course, just we have had here in Israel 9 years. We're living without any humanity. We truly hate about it, Israel. Israel is democratic country, Middle East. As our four brothers or African, they come before us. For example, like Morocco and our brothers from Ethiopia and Tunis and Lebanon and all this around the world, the people come here because Israel is a democratic country. It's Middle East. So that's why we also like other people. We came here in Israel, went to get our freedom. And want to get human rights like other people. So that's why we're here in Israel, and we are unlucky. We never got nothing. So for a while, the beginning said you are refugees, we are welcome. After that, denied us, calling us infiltrators. Now we're putting us in Holot. Now we have had, you know, 17 months here in Holot. We applied for refugees, RSD determination. We claim for asylum refugees status. And unfortunately, we didn't get answer yet. So we don't know how it's going on here. And we always keep asking. We, like other seamen, Israeli people saying, yes, this is Israel. This belongs to Israeli people. This belongs to you. So people who non-Jew, you don't care about it. Because I'm truly sure that because you are black, so that's why they keep ignoring us. Because others like Arab white people, how thousands of Arab white people is staying here, they accept the refugee or asylum seeker or like immigrants, they accept them. But you are black people, so that's why you ignore us day and night.
Brother Zaki, could you just please tell me your experiences in Sudan that led you to leave and, you know, come to Israel?
Indeed. And of course, since 2003, on 15th of May 2003, the war began in genocide, conflict between government and citizens. And without reason, they come attacking us, our villages have been destroyed by the jet up, very carrying is very heavy in weapons, and Janjaweed, Ross, Red in horses come attacking our villages and have been killed a lot of members of family.
So brothers, tell me how you feel like when you leave Holot and go into Israel society, you know, how do they see you, treat you? You know, what's your experiences?
Well, and quite some time, it's very often, not always going there in cities, different cities. And the sometimes we go over there, obviously the people look at us so strangers and looking at us very narrow eyes. He said, we are here about it, all the Kushim sent him to back in Africa. Who these people remind and then come back in a different cities and make a noise. Really, you know, we not feel, you know, like, you know, we feel so miserable because we're seeing money different nations live together in Israel. But when they see the Sudanese or like any black people, they say, oh, these people, you said, or the government said, send it, you know, send him back from Africa. Where you come here today? 2 days ago, we went to like Eshkolon. Went to spend our days there, our brothers call us, went to go over there, went to see, and then we come back. Some, you know, two you know, young ladies, they going to beach, we are coming there. Say, wow, this black pushing is still here in the Eshkolon. Eshkolon, we never seen these black people here. How did they came? He said, this is not the South Arabic. This is said it before 2 days ago. So really, this is so strange.
Brother, what's your experience in society?
Well, thank you so much for giving me a chance. Since when we came in Israel 2008 and till now, people are there treating us very bad. And you know, always they are talking in the media, Israel is the democratic, Israel is the democratic. But what we see inside in Israel, this is something unreal. Just they're talking in the media, they're Israel is democratic, but we don't see democratic in Israel. The way how we are facing difficulties and we're facing every single day we're facing, this is not a democratic country. A democratic country, they are not supposed to treating people like this. And they really treating us badly. And we never give up. And we still struggle until we get our rights.
But they know your struggles. They know where you came from and they know why you're here, right?
They know I came from. They know in our homeland, we got big war and we have no place to stay. And they said that Israel is a democratic. So we can, they must respect us, they must treat us very well, but they don't.
So you think they're not being empathetic towards your situation? You think they're not showing empathy, like they're not really understanding to your situation?
They don't understand really our situation, but we know what happened in our back home.
Do you think Israeli citizens should be more empathetic towards your situation? Do you think they understand your situation, Israeli citizens?
Israeli citizens, maybe some of them they understand, some of them don't understand. But Israel, the government know everything, who we are and why we don't want to go back. The Israeli government know, but they give them for citizens, they make the news. Why they like this? Because the citizens they don't know and they hit us. If they know we are really, nobody can hit us. They can give us the protection until the peace. We can look in our in the country. And after that, they can say to go back in your country. We don't have problem, but we don't know where to go. But if you go to the Tel Aviv or anywhere, they can say until now people here, government said to the Senate, I sent it. They hit us. If you go to the civil service, they can't go, come with someone with you. It's very completely the trouble here. But hopefully the Israeli government give us the protection and they give us our dignity until we see this, when we go, we see our family. But we not are criminal, we are just a human being. Why not give us this freedom to put in jail? Why not understand after 7 years? Because like this, they also the citizens, they hit us anyway. We feeling is terrible. If I want to go to the Tel Aviv or Beersheba, I feel not good. I afraid, not like before.
First of all, my name is Gamal Adam. I'm the one of the homeless who fell from the Darfur genocide in 2003. So I came here in Israel in 2008. And I have been here in a prison called Saronim prison here, and then so I met the judge and I did the interview, and after that so I stayed like 3 months, and then I released from here and I took myself to Tel Aviv. That I mean the migration took me by their bus to Tel Aviv and they drove me there in the garden called Lebinsky Park near the bus station. So, and they said that this is your home, you have to stay here now. So, and just they dropped me there and they went back. So I found myself in, you know, between many African people whom are suffering, so suffering, and so torment there in that garden. And then so at that time, you know, I didn't, you know, have any pocket money or something to, you know, do myself. And I asked them before they leave me, so I said that I don't have money, so I don't have nothing, so how I can stay here? So you said that this is your home, the parking or the garden cannot be my home. And they said that we don't care about that, so just we, you know, took you there, here, and you have to stay here. We don't have to, you know, give you nothing. And this is your home, and you, as you see, you're all, you know, African people here in this garden. So, and I said, okay, so I don't have, you know, any choice to do. So, and they left me there. So, and I stayed with, you know, with those people whom are living there in that garden. And after that, so, you know, at that time was the winter time, and the weather was so cold, and very severe cold was, you know, in that garden. And we don't have any blankets to recover ourselves at the same time. And I found that many people are really so suffering. They don't have nothing to bring food, or go to buy something, you know, from the shop to bring eat. And so just they are really so suffering, and they are, you know, some of them, you know, really got mental problems at the same time, and they are really physically, they are not, you know, feeling well. And so just I stayed with them. So what I have to do, I don't know, you know, no one here. And then so the rain was, you know, so raining sometimes, and the cold was really severe. And then so we, you know, tried to, you know, get some clothes from somewhere. And so there was, you know, NGOs, you know, sometimes came there in that garden to find us, and they, you know, bring us clothes and blankets. And also they, you know, start bringing us the food, you know, day by day. So, and that was, you know, really so suffering. And so just we stayed there, as you know, they said this is your home, and we don't have, you know, another home to go to stay. That, you know, just we leave it there.
Okay, guys, for the 2,500 of you brothers in Holot, is there a healthcare plan for you guys?
You know, when since we come in Holot, we have a lot of people mental problem, and they don't care about the mental problem. Just they leave you like, I don't know, they leave you like animal.
That's why I said to you, there is no healthcare, there is no education, no care, nothing. We are completely without anything, every single thing.
The healthcare here in Holot are zero. Because, you know, before, you know, we came here in Holot, so they said that, you know, when you go to Holot, there is completely thing is over there in Holot. So you can find, you know, education there, and you can find healthcare there. So, and if you became sick, you can treat it there. So, and when we came here, so we found that, you know, the healthcare is zero, and the also education program is zero.
Here we have had, you know, three is clinic. And many of our brothers whom, you know, calling suffer illness. And we have had different, you know calling sick. Some people have sugar, some people have, you know, different illness, for example. When you go over there in the clinic, you give you the same tablet. You have headache, the same tablet. Sugar, the same tablet. You see? You have
any same tablet, you see?
The same tablet.
Tablet, yeah.
You see? You have even you have like teeth pain, also give you the same tablet. Sometimes, you know, send us, you know, like a soroka. Several times. Go over there, should help you, and it's the people do. Going over there, he said no. Today your appointment not, you know we perfect yet. You go back, we will call you. You see, the people going and coming. As well as one person happened to me.
There is no health care, there is no education here in Holot. We are very terrible.
Okay, I don't see no women around in Holot. I just see men. Where are the sisters? Where are the sisters? Is there a woman, a camp for the sisters?
Obviously. This kind of pressure, if let you women come stay with you here in prison, terrible, but little bit, you know, less than what you're going on. And the people little bit in relax, they join with the sisters. So that's why I don't want to bring the sisters. This kind of, you know, pressure. So that's why.
But where are the women kept then?
Because women left him there in Tarabi.
So the women are free?
Yeah, even it's free.
Okay.
Yeah. Sometimes take it at home.
Why supposed to woman be without men? We come from Darfur, we are refugees, women, men, all we are refugees. And people get married, also they are refugees. Why they don't brought here to Holot and just they brought us with people that unmarried?
Okay, so technically all the men here are unmarried? Unmarried men?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And so, some of them, you know, they got a marriage. They say, we don't, you know, believe you. Why are you got married? Why is, you know, marriage certificate? So some people, you know, have been married. But they say, we don't believe you guys. Where are your papers, you know, first of all, for married paper? So
the women are left in Tel Aviv and other cities, and they're just there, they're free.
Yeah, women is free.
Just someone asking you, because I know that Israel has the law. We respect law anyway, but no one above the law. So if we done anything bad or our community has done everything else, we have the law, we follow the law. Why they don't ask by law, but only push by media? I need to, even if someone make mistake or something make some bad, I need to, that law, okay, the law, anyone respect the law. No one above the law, I say again, because we respect the law, we under the law, we follow the law. The same what they are saying, they're saying the giving out, the 1 month, he said, everyone is going to Holot. All right, we come to Holot, we're here.
I think the media is not saying that even if you know, follow the law or not. So, and the media is always, you know, trying to play, you know, very different games. That's how to reflect the, you know, the information to the citizens, that how they can, you know, hurt you. And as well as all, you know, the citizens are not, they are bad people. And we know that there is many Israelian, you know, citizens. They, you know, were our friends when we have been, you know, living there in the cities. And still now, so they sometimes came to visit us here in the Holot prison. And, you know, they, when, you know, they came here, they think about that, you know, what happened. And they really, so, you know, be sad for about that which we, you know, became in the life or in the place which we are staying here. So, and there is other, you know, people that really they are following the media, you know, you know, watching that which really sometimes is happening something that in Tel Aviv or in, you know, every, you know, cities, you know, because the people, you know, had been not recognized as they are refugees, and they don't have nothing, they don't have, you know, citizens, and that's why the people, they don't have nothing to do. And sometimes if there is someone, you know, went to, you know, took something, they call him that the stealer. So just not him, but they include all the refugees, you know, or the African refugees here in Israel. They call us that they are all stealers. They are not came to, you know, stay here, or they are not refugees. They come to steal our things, and they came to, you know, steal our workers, and they come to, you know, rape our girls. You know, this is the media is, you know, making. And you know, citizens, when you watch, you know, about, you know, such, you know, bad news, so they, you know, don't care about the African refugees. They, when they find you, they say, why you didn't go back to Africa? You are still here in Israel. They ask you immediately. So at that time, you know, so if you said something, maybe they, you know, try to attack. They attack you also. And this is what, you know, was happening in the cities.
Talk about South Tel Aviv, Farfari, and the life going through. Some brothers whom almost like 7 to 8 years, they didn't got visa to work. There is no one recognize him like refugee. The people do not go in the street. And also the people sang out, sometimes go to like daily job calling Chichak in Hebrew. The people going and coming. And like specifically when they never, you know, in a cage from Sudanese or Eritrean or whatever, it's still something or go fight with someone, it never happened. Just in a media telling propaganda and just hit it because them went Sudanese to let him stay here in Israel. It's very small mistake, always the media telling it, you know, make bigger.
Because they don't like you. That's why the media is focusing on you. Media is focusing only on black people, you know.
So you think the media is focusing on the negative things that happen?
Yeah,
exactly.
So like you said, one person make one mistake, yeah, and everyone gets punished for the mistake.
First you ask me, and then I will tell you who I am. And then you will go to make media. But before you ask me and you make media, I'm bad person.
You know, you don't even know the guy. Why you just keep judging?
The problem is because he don't like you. How can, you know, if, you know, I like you in deeply, I try to come in a very, in a polite way, I stay with you.
So he don't even like you. How you gonna make attack yourself?
Where you come from? Why do that? Because I don't care about you. So that's why when I see you so far, if whatever, black, white, no matter. Just especially South Tel Aviv, every single mistake done it. It's not this Sudanese or anything.
But
this have
the
same.
By the one person mistake, you must go make all like 20,000 people. You got to make a media for this all.
Because they don't like you. That's why
because
the media
they
play
hate
games.
Us. Because you are black.
Every community have a criminal, have everything. But I don't know that our community is the same community. For we seen that if we asking certain people also they have the criminals, they have. They have everybody like us, but why the media all the push us only us, or only like black here in Holot or in Tel Aviv? I need the media if we want to play the game, can play game good game, that's better. But we are not criminal, all the same. The media, he said, the media only just is push the Israel people, all the focusing the media. I hope to anyone is come sit with us here. They're asking, like face to face, we can tell the truth. I think that is my according understanding. I don't know what is the media playing. All time is playing his game, is bad games. I don't need that.
Israeli people, we say did something very bad, but we can't say all the citizens did something bad. You know. When we 2014 make a big demonstration in Tel Aviv, Kikar Rabin, a lot of Israeli people stopped with us. We did the demonstration and we struggled together until we get ourselves here in Holot. Media is played a game, government is played a game, but citizen, we can't say citizen, all the citizen, it's bad. Yeah, this is
we do agree with you. We do agree with you. Because our fingers not the same, long and short and whatever. All the people not gonna be bad people. That's why we mentioned earlier. Every community has, you know, a different base and different, you know, desire. Some people like criminal and so. And yeah, really, some Islam people stand with us. And some people haters. As well as a citizen is, you know, didn't know what's going on. The government knows. The government who, you know, dislike us telling, you know, telling its media, you know, incorrect way, and then the people hating us.
Guys, what positive change would you like to see for yourselves and the rest of our brothers and sisters who are refugees in the state of Israel?
Recognize me as, you know, Israel citizenship. I want to get, and I want to, you know, live with Israel people. I want to, you know, with peace and freedom and like others, you know, Israel people. This is what I want to do this coming time.
I hopefully soon to the Holot Detention Centre and give us our rights and our freedom. And we create with the citizen and work together and to know more our selves, and we work together.
I hope Israel government, when they will give us the kind of document and we contribute into government to share and like human being, anyone else.
Yes, I want to say we hope so. Try to get us from Holot soon and then give us documents and then we work and do what we want. Thank you.
After filming the Sudanese asylum seekers in Holot Detention Centre in 2015, their desire to be free and integrate into Israeli society for many came true. Early 2016, I returned to Israel and met with some of the brothers to discuss their current situation regarding refugee status.
You know, It's been a while.
It's a pleasure. So grateful to see you again back because you were struggling you know, across from country to country to come visit us. As well as, you know,
Same situation what you left us last year. Nothing changed.
Okay.
And as well as the government, you know, doing more pressure, let us, we are more suffer than before.
Zaki, first of all, can you give a brief understanding of what was the process that got you guys free from Holot?
We have been spent over there Holot 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
Some of us 20 months, 90 months, someone 21 months.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we lost every single thing what had before.
Okay.
After 20 months, we got released without nothing. First of all, we don't have pocket money. A big challenge is didn't allow us to go to Tal Habib or Elad. If we don't have nothing, we went over there in Tal Habib. There is some brothers over there, and able to, you know, receive us, and able to, you know, give us, you know, try to give us some, you know, money or rent in our houses, able to go and service them. But completely, the government, you know, didn't allow to go over there. The day we got released, you know, citizen then administration to organize us. He said, why you leave the people? 2 years ago, he said, want to these people want to send back to Africa. After 20 months, release these people. We don't allow to, you know, any, you know, African refugees come back to, you know, Tal Habib or other cities as well. I say, okay, no problem. After that, we, you know, separate different places. We don't know nothing. We don't have money to go to rent house. We don't have money to go to, you know, buy something to eat or wear. You see, we are keep struggle, and after 3 months or 4 months, two brothers and four brothers, it came together and collect some money, and right now we rent house, so, and then we join now.
So, Brother Zaki, what bothered me when you're speaking, I just want to know, why is it that you were allowed to go back to Tel Aviv, and what was the demonstration about?
Because they didn't like us, what, you know, like since 2012, what my regime said all, you know, fellow African, they are cancer and disease, they tell in the media.
Who said that?
The Mary Rajab is a prime minister last since 2012.
Mm-hmm.
See, you know, tell the media, he said all the black people, the disease and cancer. So they tell the media hates us. They thought if you go back again in Tal Habib, probably, you know, what is that what tells them, you know, like 4 years ago. So that's why the government, including, you know, a civilian, he, you know, didn't like us to go over there.
Okay,
to stay with them.
So we spoke last time about, you know, the way they portray and see you guys. And I know you said before that they misunderstand you guys, that they misunderstand who you are and why you're here. Do you feel that they still don't really understand your circumstances and what's really going back and what's really happening in Sudan, why you can't go home? Do you think there's a misunderstanding? Of course, we know, as you said, the media portrayed certain things about yourselves in a very negative manner, but do you think that there's a lack on the government side to really understand your circumstances?
Definitely. Government well known what why we're here. And in the beginning, of course, the government well didn't accept us as African refugees. They're very welcome. And the government put us in a flat calling Saranim. Each one spent more than 7 months to 10 months the time we came from in Sudan, since 2007, 2008, 2009. And of course, you know, we done many different, you know, investigations. And why you are here, just we are have terrible war. We lost our home. We lost all our four family. So that's why we come to Egypt, from Egypt to come to Israel, because Israel has enough experience about Holocaust. And we also, the same, you know, has Holocaust, but in a little bit smaller than Holocaust. Probably if you go to Israel government able to, you know, receive us, we stay with them, still we get peace in our home. So that's why we came here. The government in the beginning said, you are welcome. And after like 7 to 9 more years, he denied us, calling us infiltrators, and then gave us two options: either go to Africa or go to Holot. We do prefer to go to Holot because we lost our home. Even today, we go over there in Sudan, we don't have place to stay. whole our family in Iran ever since 2003. So that's why we said better to stay in the Halab.
When's the last time you've been in contact with the local government in regards to talking to them about your status?
Well, local government, just the time we went to, you know, interior minister to talk about, wanted to know, we, you know, acclimated already like 3 years ago. Even today we didn't get any answer yet. So we're supposed to get an answer.
So since you've been on road, have you tried to contact them back?
So, because if you try also, the government is not going to, you know, allow to talk to you and not going to answer you what you're asking about it. This is the challenge. So also, when we, you know, got released like 1,200 brothers, replaced as brothers more than 3,000, even today, you know, taking them in Holot.
So, good. I was just wondering, when you mentioned Holot, that comes to mind, how much brothers were released from Holot? I'm sure you said last time it was about 2,000 brothers in Holot.
No, right? Not 2,000. 1,200.
Before there was 1,200.
Yes.
Okay, so before there was 1,200 brothers in Holot.
Okay.
How many were released?
We, you know, there in Holot two different sections. Section one, we, you know, got released that day, you know, 600, you know, people. Okay, next day, and also released 600, you know, brothers,
so they, including they released quite
1,200 brothers.
So therefore, the numbers in Holot is less now, or is it?
No, it was increasing. Okay. We before 2,500, now more than 3,000.
So how is that more than 3,000? They released some. They taken some new people into Holot?
Yes. Yes, you know. We got released from Holot after like 1 month, and then, you know, start taking the people from different cities, and then like more 3 months took, you know, more than 3,000. Right now they live there in Holot, the same situation what we passed before, and they still there.
So why are they taking brothers off the streets and bring them into Holot? Are these the same brothers that they released?
Yeah, of course. This is, you know, the high experience called, they say. Israel is a democratic country, and you signed Geneva Refugee Convention since 2006. Why, you know, here in Israel more than like 50,000, you know, refugees here in Israel? Why you was very selected? You captured it, you know, you took over there like only 2,000, you know, brothers. What is the reason? The High Court asking the government. The government, There is no answer. He said the people in Israel doing a fight as Al Habib and stealing and so. It is, you know, government answered to High Court. He said, I give you 3 months, have to release all these people without reason, you know, giving over there. First of all, Holot illegal. Not have to the people putting over there. I give you 3 months to release all these people. He said, okay. After 3 months, the government done in a propaganda. And then say, no, I don't have to, I release these people. Say, why? No, because before I give to, you know, like 24 months. Right now, I want to make, you know, mines. I want to give everyone 20 months. If you, you know, close 20 months, have to, everyone go to, you know, release the one by one. So this was, you know, the government answered to High Court.
Zaki, tell me, give me a breakdown of your struggles that you face since you've come out from Holot, like the struggles you face since you've come out.
You see, most, you know, great difficulty have been in the past. The day we got released, the citizens, they start the demonstration, especially Arad and Beersheba, and Ashkelon.
So you
said the
citizens demonstrated?
Yeah, the day, you know, we got released. He said not allowed to any black, you know, African to let to come again to stay with us. You see? The citizen started down in a demonstration. It's stopping on the street. So we don't know how to do.
So the people actually went out and demonstrated it in Arad,
against us, yeah,
in Beersheba,
yeah,
and Ashkelon. They went out
and Arad.
And Arad, they went out and,
yes,
demonstrate they don't want you in the streets.
Yes, and then later on we called, you know, UNHCR, and and Amnesty International, Registrar's Watch. We call them to come and say, you know, he said, why you do that? The government, you know, give forum to stay free. So no, we don't like to come our cities. If the government release these people, why don't you know, allow to you know go there in Tel Aviv and Eilat? The most you know challenges us that time we pass. And also, you know, the police come, he said have to go, everyone have to go at home before you know go to arrest you, the citizens. This is a little bit, you know, become, you know, afraid, and then everyone gone at home. What they done? He said they don't allow to go to rent house. If you go to, like, you know, manpower to rent a house, he said, no, you are Sudanese, there is no way to rent house. You see? Some of our brothers, the newcomer, like, has been here like 1 year, 2 years, didn't, you know, go to Holot. They has, you know, house. We come, you know, stay with them, 10 brothers, 15 brothers, 20 brothers. After 2 months, 3 months, we work, and then we got money. We give money him, and then they go to, you know, they go over different places, you know, rent house for us. Now we are separated. So this is what happened in the last, you know, like.
And this is based on your 2 month visa you get allows you to work.
Yeah.
So you've got to renew your visa every 2-3 months?
Every 2 months.
Every 2 months?
Yes.
And if you don't renew, what happens?
Arrest you. Government arrest you. Migration authority arrest you and then take you back again in Saronim and Halot. If you go to Halot, Tel Aviv, you don't have ticket for bus and also arrest you to take you into Saronim.
So they haven't given you no form of financial support?
Nothing. Even no education, no healthcare service. There is nothing.
So, say you used to get sick. I mean, you. What will happen?
Just you know, try to help yourself. There is no one care about you. First of all, the people don't want to see us. If you go to die, as you go to die, there is no one care you. If you have pocket money or you know brothers, you know could help you, able to go to cover.
So there's no medical support you get at all. Within your 2 month visa, there's no. Medical support, they offer nothing?
Nothing. Just if you have money and able to go to help yourself to self. But if you don't have money, no government got to help you.
Do you think it's safe to go back to Sudan?
Ultimately not. My home, the government not stable and I'm not comfortable. All the government mentioned it. Each one went to Israel, come back, I'll kill you, said it. I want to stay in Israel.
So literally said that if you go back to Sudan, you'll be killed?
Yes. This government mentioned it. And also it's written in our passport. It said all over the world, but not Israel. It's written. It's written in our passport.
So in your passport you have, it says,
yes.
Don't go to Israel?
All over the world, but not Israel.
Okay.
After 10 years, when you go back, the government should kill you. That's what government said it. As well as I want to stay in Israel. I didn't want to go back in Sudan.
Well, that's definitely scary. You're saying if you go back to Sudan, your life will
gonna
be taken.
Yes.
Wow. So that's your real purpose. You want yours. You need to get state. You need. You definitely. That's why you're crying for refugee status.
Exactly. So that's why I keep, you know, asking the government and keep struggling. I keep waiting.
Their passports were stamped with the mark of death.
Wow.
Authorities must have seen this stamp in their passport.
Man,
I wonder why they haven't acted upon it.
Your last message, your only last word you want to say to the government, to Israeli people? I mean, they don't really understand how serious it is that your life is actually in. It's in their hands. Technically, your life is in their hands. They send you back, you're literally dead. Is there anything you want to say to the government, to the people of Israel, to make them really understand the seriousness of you, the seriousness of your life? You know, that those who are demonstrating against you, because of course we know not every Israeli is against you guys, but those who are demonstrating against you, those who don't really understand, or they're being misinformed or miseducated about your circumstances. Is there any last thing you want to say to Israel people on the whole, to the government on the whole?
Ultimately, we, you know, have been passing is a great challenge since we arrived in Israel. And also I thank God, I thank the Israel government for welcoming us and hosting us in his nation, and also some fellow Israelis. And of course, the government will name what's going on in our home country, since 2003, even today. We're losing our people day and night, and harassing and raping our sisters, and taking every single thing what we left. We left since like 30 years ago, 50 years ago, what we have, the government, you know, is taken, and then killing the people, and done ethnic cleansing in our home. So we're lucky enough to, you know, we succeed to come enter here in Israel. Even we didn't get any human rights and refugee status, and also we thank the government, and we stay, we went to stay with them. We are women, they are human too. The Israel is nation, have to stay with them.
So you technically want the Israel people to really understand yourselves, really understand your struggles, and that what you've been through, that's what you're saying.
And definitely, you know, I have been active different NGOs, international, just international, like Amnesty International, and African Development Center and IRDC, UNHCR. Also, we told every single thing what happened in our home country and is still going on. And also, we done in, you know, many demonstrations. We show, you know, Brazil, what, you know, going on in our home country and day and night. The government, you know, well known, and as well as in, you know, civilian, as well as well known too, what is going on in our home and why we are here and how much we suffer. Everyone and Israeli people, they know well, as well known what happened to our home and is still going on in our home.
Well, Zaki, I just want to leave with these words that, you know, definitely keep me posted. I pray to God that, you know, things work out for you guys, because I think you're an amazing brother. You've got, you know, you've got a good heart. You know, talking to you, getting to know you over the period of time, speaking to you, you know, over the internet. And, you know, I'm really feeling for you, brothers. And I do hope that Israeli government do realize the seriousness of your situation, you know, and help you, brothers. As well as I hope the Israeli society and the community that stand against you really try to look, try to understand and learn about you before they condemn you, and realize that, you know, just like everybody else, you guys just want, you know, someone to see you and understand who you really are and what you're really going through. So I do wish you all the best.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so grateful.
I was left shocked yet troubled. The importance of refugee status being granted to Sudanese asylum seekers was no doubt a matter of life and death.